हेलो फोक्स, वेलकम बैक टू द एडुपीडिया वर्ल्ड एंड आई एम अभिनय गुप्ता। सो टुडे अगेन विल कंटिन्यू विद द टॉपिक द अमेंडमेंट इन द कंपनीज लॉ, राइट? एंड विल वाइंड अप द एंटायर एग्जेम्पशंस ऑन द प्राइवेट कंपनी टुडे। सो दोज़ हु हैव नॉट अंडरस्टूड एंड सीन द प्रीवियस लेक्चर्स, प्लीज गो देयर, विटनेस दोज लेक्चर्स, अंडरस्टैंड दोज एंड देन कम बैक एंड देन विल वाइंड अप एंटायर थिंग, राइट? So far, what amendments have we covered? Right, we have covered the entire 14 sections relating to the amendment of the Section 8 companies, right? And we have also covered around 7 exemptions on the private company. We have just 2 more to go and we'll cover it in this lecture, right? So what are the exemptions that we have covered in the private companies? So these are the list of the exemptions, right? The 4 plus 4, 8 plus 1, 5. 9 exemptions, right? And we have covered section 272, clause 76, section 160, 162, 180, 184, 185, 188. Remaining are section 196 and 141, subsection 3, clause G. Remember, I told you that, yeah, section 185, out of these, 185 is the only section from where you can get a full-fledged question. Otherwise, you may be asked at the end of the question, what would be your answer if it was a private company? That is the kind of question you would get for the other sections so far, right? But for 185, you may get a full-fledged 4-mark question, right? And also on section 188, that is the referring to the first exemption, right? Referring to section 2, clause 76. Over there also, you may get a full-fledged 4-mark question. So be prepared with that. So in section 2, clause 76, we have seen the exemption from taking the board and the member's approval for the group company transactions, right? In section 160, we have seen that the limit, that the deposit of rupees 1 lakh is not required for the directors who are standing for the directorship, right? In section 162, we have seen that the appointment of directors, appointment of more than one director, can be done by passing a single resolution. That is an exemption to the private company. In section 180, we have seen that the restriction on the 4 powers of the board has been taken away and now the board can utilize its power on itself, right? It need not receive the special resolution from the members. Then we have section 184, where we have seen that the directors are now supposed to disclose their interest as usual, but even after disclosing their interest, they will be allowed to participate in the meeting. That is the exemption, that is the difference, right? Section 185, loan to directors, we have discussed it in detail in the previous class, right? There are 3 conditions that you need to satisfy to get loans. Earlier, you were not allowed to give loans to directors, but for the private company, if you satisfy 3 conditions, you would be getting the loan, right? What were those conditions? You remember, first we told I told you some shortcuts to remember. The first thing was that it should be a self-formed company, that you should be the only people in injecting the capital into the company. You should not have any borrowed money from the other body corporate. That means you should have no holding. It should be your money, you're allowed to withdraw it. Second, the leverage. Remember that your borrowing should not be more than 2 times of the paid up share capital, or rupees 50 crore, whichever is lower. That was the condition, but I told you in practical, we'll basically check the 2x paid up share capital limit. Right, because 50 crore is a rare situation. And the third point that we had over there was that the company should not have been defaulter in the repayment of the loan and interest of that borrowing at the time of making the loan. If all these 3 conditions are satisfied, you may grant loan to your director. Section 188, what we covered is the second proviso. The first was covered in section 2 clause 76, the second proviso was covered over here, according to which now even the members who are interested will be allowed to vote in the general meeting, right? So those were the exemptions that we have seen so far. Now we will cover the next 2 sections remaining, that is section 196 and 144(3)(g). So what does section 196 say? So section 196 deals with the appointment of the managing director, whole-time director or the manager. So although you have a one-liner exemption in this section also, but I would prefer that you understand the provision of the entire section we will revise the provision of the entire section, and then I will let you know what the exemption is and what is the story behind that exemption, what is the need for that exemption, right? You will automatically get that feel while we are discussing the provisions. So the provisions of 196, the first is that the MD and the manager to be mutually exclusive. What does that mean? That in no company should an MD and a manager be appointed at the same time. So either you should have a MD or you should have a manager. You cannot have both of them in a single company, right? Next is that the maximum tenure for that MD or manager, whosoever is appointed, should be 5 years, right? But that doesn't mean that after 5 years even they will have a cooling period. No, it's your managing director is the managing director of the company. If you give him a cooling period of 3 years, who will manage the company then? Right? He is an integral part of the company. You cannot give him a cooling period. So he will be appointed for a tenure of 5 years, and then 5 years, and then 5 years, and then 5 years, for as long as you want. Right? But at one time you cannot pass a resolution, okay, for the next 4 tenures he is appointed. No. You can appoint him only in the last year. After 4 years has lapsed, the last year is running for the 5th year. That is the only year when you can reappoint a MD or a manager. Right? So the maximum tenure will be 5 years. That is the second provision of section 196. The third provision talks about the disqualification. So there are 4 disqualifications that it talks about. Number one is that if a person is below the age of 21 or above 70 years. So the bracket is 21 is 70 years, you can be the MD or the manager or the hotel director of a company. Right? But you can appoint a person greater than 70 years also, but for that case you will have to pass a special resolution. Otherwise you cannot. Right? So general provision you cannot, but yeah, special situations are there. Pass a special resolution and appoint him, no issues with that. Right? The second condition is undischarged insolvent. So if the person is an undischarged insolvent or he has at any time been adjudicated as insolvent, he will not be allowed to be an MD or a manager or a whole time director. Right? Then if he has at any time suspended payment of the creditors or made any composition with them, or generally makes a composition with them, right, then he will not be allowed. I mean, he will be disqualified from being a MD, WTD or a manager. And the last disqualification is that if he has been convicted by the court at any time, right, and then he has also been sentenced with that conviction for more than 6 months. So if these 4 disqualifications are tracked, he will be disqualified from being a managing director, full-time director or manager of a company. Right? So basically you understand that these 3 are casual qualifications for them. Mutual exclusive, 5 years and disqualification. Okay, agreed. It is nothing very vital, right, for the appointment of an MD, WTD or manager. But yeah, now if you move on to the next point, right, that is the appointment is subject to the provisions of 197 and Schedule 5. Provision of 197 is not a big deal, but Schedule 5, mind it. Section 197 deals with the remuneration of the directors of a public company, right? But now Schedule 5 is actually a task. So basically Section 197 is not a task, but Schedule 5 is actually a burdensome procedure. And if at any point of time you are not complying with Schedule 5, then you will have to seek an approval from the central government, right? So that is one condition for your disqualification. Sorry, it's not a disqualification, the provisions continue, right? And the fifth part, 196 subsection 5, it says that once the director is appointed by the board, right, once the MD or the WTD or manager is appointed, then they will already start performing, and then you will hold a general meeting. And if that person is not approved in the general meeting, if the approval is not granted, right, and then the act done between his approval in the board till his disapproval in the general meeting, the intervening acts would remain valid, right? And if he is elected in the general meeting also, he will continue to work and the acts will definitely be valid. So that was the provision, right? But now there is an exemption given to the private company that they are not required to follow the provision of subsection 4 and subsection 5. We need not comply with it. Right? So that is a very great relief for them. Because Schedule 5 is very detailed. you have hell lot of compliance as per Schedule 5. So a private company, do you think that is required, that is important? Again, we go back to the same old funda, that the private company is a closely held company. Everything they do here, there are 2-3 people they need to decide. They are the directors, they want to make one of them as MD or a manager. They are free to make it. Why do you make it so cumbersome for them? Why do we need to abide by all the provisions of Section 5? That is not needed. It is needed in a public company, but in private company it is not needed. It is a closed company, it is a family company, let them perform. Right? So that is why this was withdrawn. It is an exemption given to them that you are not supposed to abide by the provisions of 4 and 5. No, I don't understand why 4 and 5. The entire 196 could have been exempted. The other three are useless. The only problem is in 4 and 5. And that has been withdrawn. That has been exempted. So ultimately, as 197 is applicable on public company, now 196 is also applicable on public companies only. If you look at the crux, legally, yeah, it is applicable on private companies, only first three things, right? And the subsection 4 and 5 are not applicable. So basically, those three are not a material thing, right? So if you understand in a totality, then 196 and 197 both are applicable on private public companies now. Private companies are exempt from them. That is one thing you need to understand, right? So that is the only exemption. Next, you have the last section, that is section 141(3)(g), ceiling limit of the number of audits. So what does section 141 subsection 3 clause g say? So it says, it does not say, it defines a limit, the limit on the number of audits. So this section basically restricted the number of companies, including private companies, for which a person could be a statutory auditor to 20. That means any auditor can be a statutory auditor of maximum 20 companies. Maybe 20 public company or 20 private company, half public, half private, half others, whatever it be. The maximum limit is 20 companies, not more than that. So now, do you think is that justifiable? 20 public company, understood. Those are big companies, you cannot perform more audits than that. But private companies, they are small companies. Yeah? There are a hell lot of small, very small companies. Now if you go on an audit of private companies, if you have just 20 private companies, small companies, small capital, small turnover, small audit fees, how will you survive? It's a practical thing to understand. You don't have a lot of work in a private company and you don't get a lot of fees from that. How do you survive? And how many CAs do you have to comply with all the private companies? People will definitely want, if they have a limit, they will want to go for public companies if they can. They will not want to come to private companies. Right? So what they did is, they have extended this limit. That means, from the ambit of this limit of 20 companies, right, they have excluded the 1% companies. That 20 companies, the limit is still there, but 1% company will not be included in the limit. That means you can do any number of audits of the 1% company. It also excludes the dormant companies. That means you can do any number of audits of dormant companies as well. Dormant companies are basically inactive companies, right? So if they're not active, basically you don't need anything over there. So they have been excluded. 1% company is a company with single ownership. How big? It will be a small company, right? Then the notification also excluded the small companies. Now what are small companies? If you go back to the definition that is contained in section 2 clause 85, it says that small companies are companies other than public companies, first thing. That means they are private companies, first. The second requirement is that their turnover should be less than 2 crores or such higher amount as may be prescribed. But the higher amount also cannot be prescribed more than 20 crores. So consider it to be 2 crores, right? And the paid up share capital should be less than 50 crores. That is the definition of a small company, right? And the last inclusion in that is your private companies having paid up share cap of less than rupees 100 crores, right? So it is 1% company, dormant company, small companies, and private companies having paid up share capital of less than 100 crores. So do you think there was a requirement of specifying small companies because all the companies that are covered in the fourth part, the private companies having paid up share capital less than 100 crore, would at any time include the small companies, right? Because over there you're talking about the paid up share capital of being maximum up to 50 lakhs, not crores, which may be maximum up to 5 crores if prescribed, right? And again, do you feel there are a lot many private companies with paid up share capital of more than 100 crores? As of now, no. In future, maybe they have, but as of now, no. So that means all the private companies are covered, right? So all 1% company, dormant company, and all private company. So for examination purpose, if you are checking the limit, basically you should check the limit of the private company, that will be enough, right? You should write small companies, but if you check the limit of private company and that is satisfied, then that is a good compliance. So they will be excluded in determining the audit limit threshold of 20 companies. So now I hope you are clear with the exemptions for the private companies as well, along with the section 8 companies that we have already discussed in the past. So all the sections, the 9 sections of private companies have been covered, right? If you have any query, go back to the previous lectures and see it over there. So that will be all for the day. We'll be covering up the next provisions relating to the government company, actually the exemptions of the government company and the Nidhi company in the following lectures, right? So until then, this is Abhinay Gupta signing off. Thank you. Bye-bye.